Good evening, everyone. I'm calling the public hearing on the town council's tentative budget for fiscal year 2017-2018 to order it at 6:02 p.m. Purpose of this hearing is to provide electors and taxpayers, as specified by the Newington Charter, Section 805, the opportunity to express their views regarding the town council's tentative budget for fiscal year 2017 to 2018. There is a sign-up sheet on the podium for those wishing to speak. If you do come forward to speak, please identify yourself, your name, your address. Please limit your comments to 3 minutes. There is a clock working. And the acoustics in this room are horrible, so please speak into the mic and enunciate clearly. Before we begin, however, I'm going to give an overview of the tentative budget. And I hope I pushed the right button on the clicker. Oh, good. We're now at the penultimate stage of a process that began late last year with the budget preparation. Since the end of December, the beginning of January, the departments have submitted their budget requests. The town manager has reviewed them and prepared a proposed budget. And the town council has had several meetings to review that proposed budget, analyze it, and make adjustments. You'll note that tonight we do have the public hearing. Following the public hearing, we'll have a regular meeting to discuss any changes to the tentative budget. And this all comes to a head on April 18th at a special meeting of the council, when the budget will be adopted and the mill rate for the next year will be fixed. Before going on, I would like to give a shout out to the town department heads. They all realized what a tough year we are facing, and the size of their budgets, the minimal increases shown, reflect that concern and that awareness. As I did last year, I'm going to begin talking about revenues, the money that comes into the town. And I'm going to go over the three major categories of revenues. First is the grand list on which the property taxes are based. This is not good news. This is not good news. And the entire budget is one that's been constrained by the revenue picture. As you can see on the slide, the grand list, as it was published in January, and is actually as of October 1st, 2016, showed an overall decrease of 0.19%. Real estate was down 0.58%, personal property slightly up, and motor vehicles slightly up. The grand list for real estate decreased by $5 million. It's primarily a result of court cases on major properties in town that came out of the revaluation. There were 10 court cases, and they were all found for the plaintiffs. Another hit we took was a change of the old, the former clinical lab building on the Hartford Hospital campus off East Cedar Street that was taken over by Hartford Hospital when Clinical Lab moved out and subsequently became tax exempt as part of the hospital property. That resulted in a $2.9 million decrease in the grand list by itself. State aid is another category of revenues to the town. And as you can see, state aid as a percentage of the budget has been gradually declining over the past 10 years, from 17.5% in 2008 to 15.5% in 2018. The educational cost sharing grant similarly has, as a percent of school spending, has decreased. Again, from 2008, it was 23% of the school budget. 2018, the legislature is still at work, and we don't know what we're going to get. We all know what's going on at the Capitol in Hartford. The state budget is still being worked on by the legislature. The anticipated deficit for this year for the state is $45 million. And as a result, we in Newington alone are looking at reductions of about $1.5 million in municipal revenue sharing, school transportation grants, educational cost sharing, and the local capital improvement program. Looking ahead to the next fiscal year, the projected deficit for fiscal year 18 is $1.7 billion. And we're looking at the elimination of grants for municipal projects and major changes to the education cost sharing grant formula. You note a bullet up there for teachers' retirement. The governor had proposed putting a large portion of the teachers' retirement payments onto municipalities, whereas the state previously had been carrying the whole load. In Newington's case, that would result in an additional $3 million hit. Right now at the legislature, it does not look like that is viable. That does not mean it's not going to pass, or it does not mean that it's not going to pass in some form and gradually be worked in. Fund balance is the third revenue category I want to talk about. It's the town's savings account. It's the cushion. The finance director sternly scolded me and said, don't dare use the word slush fund. But it is basically the fund that is unexpended and unencumbered that has accumulated at the end of each fiscal year. Right now, the balance is at about $15.5 million. We are proposing using $2 million to balance the budget. That would leave a balance of $13.5 million, or 11% of the budget. This fund covers unforeseen expenditures, like court decisions, arbitration rulings, or natural disasters. It would also help the town in the event of revenue shortfalls from state aid or the downturn in the economy, or a top taxpayer moving out. We want to keep a balance of at least 10% of the budget in that fund balance. And the reason is that's one of the factors bond rating agencies look at in establishing a rating for the town. Since we're anticipating going out for bonding for a new town hall or town hall renovation project, we want as high a bond rating as possible, because that in turn results in lower interest rates for our borrowing. Moving over to the expenditure side, we're looking at a budget in round numbers of $116 million, $35.3 million for town government operations, $70.4 million for the Board of Education, $3.9 million for the Metropolitan District, $5 million for capital improvements, and $1.1 million for debt service. I don't know who that is, but we're not taking calls. The budget is basically a no growth, no change budget with one exception. One position's been added, a public safety, a public safety dispatcher for the police department, the cost of which will be offset by reduced overtime. No other positions are proposed on the town government side. This chart on the screen now gives you an idea of the changes made over the life cycle of this particular budget, with the council tentative showing a 2% increase in town government operations, 0.3% increase in the Board of Education, reduction in capital improvements, and a 7% increase for the Metropolitan District. The Metropolitan District, for the most part, is out of our hands. But I do want to make a note that we all know that Hartford is possibly facing bankruptcy, possibly defaulting on its Metropolitan District assessment, and the district had been looking to the member towns to make up the difference. The tab for that for Newington would have been almost $720,000. This budget draws the line in the sand with the Metropolitan District. That amount is not included in the budget. We intend to fight any attempt by the MDC to make us pay something like that. I also want to make note of supplemental resources. Supplemental funds, rather, available to the Board of Education, totaling approximately $3.5 million. There is $515,000 in a non-lapsing, that is, it doesn't disappear at the end of the fiscal year, a non-lapsing account that was approved by the council last year. There's an anticipated health benefit credit of $1.3 million coming this fiscal year, and about $1.1 million expected in 2017-2018. There is also a public school CIP fund with revenue from sources like proceeds from rental of school properties that has a balance of approximately $800,000. And again, that's close to $3.5 million available. So, in short, total appropriations increase $242,480, or 0.2%. Against that, we have a state aid decrease of $2 million. Those factors lead to a mill rate increase of 2.4%. Slide on the screen now shows the impact on the property tax bill of an average Newington house assessed at $147,000, mill rate ranging from 39.81 if the department request budget were adopted, to a mill rate of 37.36 if the manager proposed budget were adopted, to a mill rate of 36.59 based on the council tentative budget. And you note how the increase is impacted by the actions at each level in the bottom row. I do want to add a note with this budget again. We are at the point now where I don't think Newington can continue to budget by cutting paper clips and copy paper. We're down to the bone. I think whoever's sitting here or standing here next year delivering this presentation will probably be introducing some major structural staffing and service changes to address both the economic situation and taxpayer concerns while at the same time providing services. And with that, I'm wrapping up my remarks, and I thank you for your attention. Before beginning, people stepping to the podium, I did receive one letter today. It was followed by a second message asking that it be read into the record. Councilor Del Buna, would you do the honors?
This is from Forrest C. Helvey, PhD, 282 Lamplighter Lane. Mayor Zartarian, I hope this finds you well. I wanted to write you to speak in support of the requested budgetary increase for the Board of Education for the upcoming year. I have voiced these thoughts to Dr. Collins, and I wanted to reach out to you as well. As I understand it from reading through the public documents, the increase primarily aims to cover only the current costs, which increase year to year. No further programs were being added, nor were lost positions being funded, per my understanding. Of course, there's little to get excited about in advocating for this incredibly modest increase, as there are early elementary age students sitting in classes of 23 plus, and the increase does little to nothing to improve their situation. My oldest son is one such student, and there are kids who have IEPs, 504s, and SRBI behavior plans who require additional teacher and tutor aid support. I know this because both of my sons benefit from the support that the teachers, counselors, and staff at Ruth Chafee offer these students. The result is that those 23 students end up creating a strain on the teacher that is equal to anywhere from 25 to 30 students when you take into account the amount of extra support and attention they need. And it takes its toll, as evidenced by emails that have timestamps after 11 p.m., meetings that take place after 4:30 p.m. to accommodate our working schedules, and the many hours we do not see that are spent prepping lessons and programs for the students. There are simply too many kids to get it all done in a remotely normal workday. As one who is both an educator and married to a public school educator, there is no exaggeration, and rest assured it's not sustainable despite our collective desires to do what's best for our respective students. I can empathize with the need for prudent fiscal management. I'm sure you heard about the significant shifts taking place in higher education here in Connecticut with what amounts to a massive consolidation of all colleges and universities over the next 2 years. Times are tight, and it doesn't appear to be getting better anytime soon. But again, we also risk long-term injury if we starve ourselves too. Too often we find ourselves in combative postures. I was encouraged to read in a local paper that discussions were taking place this year between the Council and Board of Ed so that we might avoid the sad state of discourse that took place last spring. Should this be the case, I find it greatly encouraging. We need viewpoints from both sides of the aisle to effect positive change and find solutions to these financial challenges. I trust that you and the members of the Council continue to hold not just opportunities for dialogue, but sincerely work with everyone involved in this process to ensure we do not add further strain and potentially compromise the quality of the education that our teachers and professional staff are providing our students. As a matter of procedure, you may share this letter with other members of the Board of Education and Town Council. Thank you. Forrest C. Helvey, PhD.
And councilors, you should have copies of that letter, and I did send a copy to Dr. Collins with the request that it be distributed to Board of Education members as well. Okay, Linda, you have a list of people who have signed up to speak. Would you start calling?
There was?
Oh, I'm sorry, you have one?
Hold on.
Yeah, there's one more letter sent to all of us.
Oh, you, okay, they must have just come in then.
Do you want to read it?
Hello, my name is Judy Bednar.
My husband graduated from Newington High School in 1973. Our two daughters graduated from Newington High School in 2006 and 2009. One is a dental hygienist, the other one is a psychologist. I do not have anyone in the school system at this time. Each year, the Board of Education sends the Town Council a budget that 9 out of 10 times is rejected and reduced. Last year, they did not get an increase they requested because they saved money from a prior year and were told to use that money. This year, because they're getting a rebate, the Town Council has decided the Board of Education should not get the money they're requesting. Does it seem fair that because they save money, they are being punished? If I were on the Board of Education, I would stop trying to save money to put into a reserves fund because we get punished when they do. Each year that the Board of Education gets denied what it in good faith believes is a reasonable request to address the problems of school safety, building upkeep, and the education of our children. I would like the Council to reinstate the Board of Education's original request for their funding. Yes, I do understand the concern over what the state of Connecticut is doing, going to be giving our town. It's weighing heavy on our budget issues. What if we get nothing? Would a modest 3% tax increase ease that by letting us put money into our own reserve account? I think it would be better than having double-digit increases next year because the state of Connecticut, again, is expecting another budget deficit. I am now retired, but a small increase is easier than a large one down the line. If the town council is trying to be fiscally responsible, let me ask you questions. How much money has been spent on repairs to the town hall over the last few years since it was first brought up that it needed work? How much money has been spent on study after study in the last few years to figure out what kind of town hall we want? How much will it cost us taxpayers to hold yet another referendum to ask if you want to spend money on fixing the town hall? The price of material and labor go up every year that we sit back and wait for a plan to be approved. A loaf of bread and a gallon of milk are not the same price today as they were last year. My husband and I ran a successful business in town for over 30 years. Each year we invested in our business by replacing old and outdated equipment. It is not responsible to wait until it's not working anymore because then we couldn't run our business. The $25 million price tag that town council has agreed upon recently would have built a bigger and better town hall when it was first came to light that the old building was falling apart. I would like to ask each member of our town government to act like they are chairmen of the board, running a company called Newington. If there was a way to do that, do away with both the Republican and Democratic Party, I would be all for it, because then everyone is on the same team working for the same thing. Voting would not be along party lines as it is now, and would be along, we would all get along better working together for the sake of a company called Newington. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Terry Borgeson, 45 Glenview Drive in Newington. My wife and I have been here 30 years. We consider it our town, and we love it here. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for serving the town, all of you. I know you don't get paid for it, and I know it can be a pain, so I really appreciate what you do. A couple observations and a couple comments on the budget. I'm not going to get into specifics. I'm just going to give you, to me, a little bit of an overview. People, businesses, developers make decisions on why Newington. We look at our grand list, decrease 0.19%, real estate down 0.58%, real estate decrease $5 million. When this happens, this takes down our ability to pay for infrastructure, to pay for services, to pay for education, to pay for maintenance. Costs are going to continue to rise. Salaries are going up, benefits are going up. They're contractual. There's not a lot we can do about that. Health insurance, infrastructure repairs, energy. Those things are going up. So we need to be in a position to be attractive to all of these various constituents. The people that live here already, and the people that might want to live here, the businesses that might want to come here, the developers that might want to clean up some of this dirt we have all over the place where we haven't done anything for a long period of time. What message are we sending with this budget? I'll give you a couple of examples. We're going to save $27,000 by not opening the library on Sundays. That equates to 90 cents a person out of 30,000 people in Newington a year to not open the library on Sundays. Well, guess what? Our kids need to use the library on Sundays. There are people that work all week that needs to use the library. I've gone over there to see about some meetings. Sunday meetings would be good. It sends a terrible message to people that might consider coming here that we don't care that much about our library, that we're not going to spend $27,000. The no increase in education. There are families that want to come to Newington. They want to bring their kids here. They want to go to school here. We have a very strong school system. Dr. Collins, I mean, I've been on both sides, but with Dr. Collins, I've seen him, you know, when he inflated and get to here. He's coming in with realistic budgets now, okay? The STEM stuff that he's doing is very important. Getting the kids to be involved in community service is very important. It's making a difference to the town. But if we don't increase, if we stay where we are, people are going to look at that and say, why would I bring my family to Newington? I look at infrastructure disrepair. I was at the board, the public yeah, Department of Recreation today. It looks terrible. You walk down the hallway, it looks terrible. You walk in, the building is hurting. This place is hurting.
Mr. Borgeson, would you summarize, please?
Oh, yes. Yes, sir. I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. What we all need to care about is the biggest thing. Property values are going down. I've talked to real estate people. Because of what's occurring here, property values are going down. We need to get together. We need to figure this out because state and federal are not going to be good in the future. We need to look at the question of what we need to do to unite Newington to move us forward. And I hope that we can do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening, Gail Whitney, 31 Old Hatchery Lane. Take my glasses off to read, sorry. My husband and I moved to Newington in 1979 because friends of ours had been here for quite a while and all they talked about was how great the schools were in the community. And with both of us working full-time, we did not have the opportunity to avail ourselves to become part of the community. However, that changed in 1983 when our daughter was born. We were amazed to receive a congratulatory letter from then Superintendent of Schools William Ward welcoming our daughter and saying that he looked forward to her attending kindergarten in 1988. We knew then that we wanted to become a more integral part of the community. Our daughter had a fantastic education in Newington, and she's been teaching at John Wallace for the past 11 years. She participated in many Parks and Rec programs, and in 1986 attended her first library pajama story time, which at that time was held at the Senior Disabled Center because the library was undergoing renovation 30 plus years ago. Our family loves the Lucy Robbins Wells Library, and I would say that between the two of us, my husband and I are there probably two or three times a week. We really miss Sunday hours. Families are so busy these days that Sunday hours are a real family time. I would encourage you to find a way to restore Sunday hours at the library. I also don't want Newington being known for their lottery shootings. I want Newington to be known for its nationally recognized schools, nationally accredited senior disabled center, having the top library, one of the top 10 libraries in Connecticut, and our wonderful Parks and Rec programs. And if you'll indulge me one more minute, I just want to put my hat on for the, I'm also the executive director of the Newington Chamber of Commerce. And I'm here today to advocate for the chamber business members and all Newington businesses. I know the grand list is down, and I know that small businesses in Newington probably don't really help the grand list. But the landlords and developers do, and I believe that they have a hard time getting tenants because one of the main issues tenants are facing are sign restrictions. TPZ has a moratorium on temporary signs and are working on revising the regulations. TPZ needs to work with and for the business community to come up with a uniform sign that meets all requirements and allow businesses to display this uniform sign during business hours. Newington's economy needs to grow, and Newington needs to restore the reputation as being pro-business. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Walt Soplinski, 35 Whiteside Street, Newington. And I've been a resident for nearly 45 years. And I have to say it's a great town. And I'd like to thank the council for the opportunity to speak with them tonight.
Are you a Newington resident?
Question?
Hold on one second. Someone called, so he's just trying to.
Yeah,
sure.
Okay. Can you hold on? Somebody's speaking right now. And I'll get right back to you. Okay? I'm sorry.
Not a problem. everyone has to do more than one thing at a time today. That's our world. I'm here tonight to ask the board to restore money to the Board of Education, the library, and indeed Parks and Recreation. I guess I had said that I've lived in town for nearly 45 years, and I have observed a lot of patterns and cycles. This is not the first time Newington has faced budget issues and crises and conflicts with the state. And one of the things that I just like to share as an observation from an old guy is that when Newington starts making cuts like this, especially to our library and school and park and rec, it starts us on the road, the slippery road to neglect. And I have seen in the past where two, three, four difficult years, now the town is facing a huge expenditure with a large increase. And it's just, it's not a good way to operate. Just as I do with my own home, it's important at times to make the necessary investments. And yes, sometimes it's difficult, but it's important in the long run. This budget is not just for this year, even though you have legal responsibilities. It is also for many years to come. So I think, like our Native Americans who looked for decision making based on what would be good for generations into the future, I think the town of Newington needs to do the same. And one of the ways I think we can help ourselves and look for our future generations is to do the right thing and perhaps say no to the state of Connecticut when it comes to cost shifting, which is one of the issues that's going on with the governor's current budget. It's time to say no to the state and say yes to the young people of Newington and to all the other great residents who live in this community. I know I've been in to speak with the mayor earlier when he was first elected and asked, when is Newington going to say no to cost shifting and unfunded mandates? Maybe this is our opportunity. Maybe these are the times that are pushing us in that direction. And I'm sure you have the support of our state representative and state senator on this cost shifting issue. Would that be correct? So if every town has that support, then cost shifting won't happen, and that will ease the burden that you face financially. So in summing up, once again, I would like to see a restoration of the budget for the Board of Education, the town library, and any rec and park and rec department improvements that could be had. So thank you very much for your time, and I do appreciate your listening. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm going to try and get the speakerphone working, take this call. Are you still there?
I am.
Okay, please give your name and address and limit your remarks to 3 minutes, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Mark LaPierre. I currently reside at 194 Cedar Street here in Newington. And I just wanted to raise the issue about the potential for allowing backyard chickens here in Newington. Based on my research,
hold on. This is a public hearing on the budget only.
Hold back a second.
He may be trying to reach town. Are they Democratic or Republican?
Bye bye. Okay, unless we can tax chickens.
You might.
Okay. Now there's an idea.
As a resident,
there's an idea.
Drive cars.
Hi, Chris DeFrancesco, 255 Beacon Street. I'm a product of the Newington Public School System, graduated in 1991, and at the time, I was classmate with the head of the Board of Education, by the way. We both graduated Newington High in 1991, and at the time, I didn't appreciate what a great school system it was, but I do now. My daughter is in third grade at Patterson, and she's thriving, and I just can't say enough about how great the school system has been for our family and how much I appreciate it today. I look at it not only as a parent with a daughter in the school system, but as a resident of this community that adequately funding our school system is an investment in our community, not just for the benefit of my child, but for all of us. And I can't say for sure, but I trust that the Board of Education is not being extravagant with its budget requests. With the state budget in the shape that it's in, whether they shift education cost sharing in a disadvantageous way to our town, teacher pension, state employee retirement, whatever those cost shifts end up being, whether they end up at the town level or at the state level, we're all gonna be ending up paying for it one way or another. Why not do what we can to keep Newington give it that advantage that it has, the reputation of it being such a great community and having such a terrific school system. I understand and appreciate that you're in an impossible situation with the budget, not having any idea what it's going to come down from Hartford, and having to make some decisions based on speculation. And I also understand that you were elected to, most of you anyway, were elected with a pledge that you would hold the line on spending. And if that is the will of the electorate, then I will respect that. That's one of the great things about our process here. But speaking for myself, I've had nothing but positive experiences with the Newington school system. And if it requires me to have to pony up a little more in property taxes, I'm okay with that as an investment in our own children's future and in the future of our great community. So I appreciate the opportunity to speak and for your service to our town.
Thank you. That's the end of the sign-up list. Anyone else who would like to speak? Come on up.
Hi, my name is Alicia Sharmet. I live at 56 Francis Avenue. I first moved to Newington in 1976. I was three. I didn't have a choice as to where I lived, but I was very fortunate that my parents chose Newington because I got a wonderful education here. Unfortunately, I moved away before high school, but I moved back here in 2009, and we chose Newington because of the school system. We looked in West Hartford, we looked in Cheshire, we looked in a lot of other, we looked in Glastonbury, and we chose Newington. Not only because it's the community that I grew up in, actually that made it a harder decision, but because the schools are so amazing. My children are in fifth grade and seventh grade at Martin Kellogg Middle School. They are both involved in the amazing music program we have here. My daughter just acted in the Once Upon a Mattress production, which was amazing. We have this amazing resource in Newington that draws families to it, and we have to invest in it. So I please, please grant the Board of Education the increase they're asking for. Thank you.
Thank you.
John Bichon, 56 Maple Hill Avenue. I want to start out by saying that normally I would be up here telling you whether I support your proposed budget or not, but unfortunately there's a wrinkle in this year's situation that I have trouble making a decision. And that comes down to this rumor of the St. Mary's school purchase by the Board of Ed. So I wish you would speak to this. You need to get as much of the information out as possible so that people like me could make a decision. I don't know whether I support you or not now. You know, historically, I supported you strongly, every single one of you, both sides of the table and independent. But I'm left wondering and curious. So is it a rumor? Is it true? If it is true, you need to get as much of that information out as possible. I'm going to go on the assumption that it is factual, and I would be... You know, my background is in maintaining buildings of that era. I think in better times, it might have been a great idea to own and to secure that property. But I think the timing is just terrible right now. So, you know, I think the Board of Ed controls something like a couple hundred acres. I don't think purchasing more real estate is a wise decision at this time. Again, based on the timing and the situation we're in, the economic malaise we're in, we're talking about 10 years of zero growth in the tax base and 30% increase in expenditures in that time, 100% increase in expenditure in 19 years. So I don't see how throwing more money at the situation makes it better. Think about that. We've doubled our budget in 19 years, the lifespan of a high school student, I like to say, or a little bit more. That's unsustainable. I know that word gets overused in budget time, but I think that literally it is unsustainable. So I understand that it's difficult, especially when you're sitting at that table, to make cuts, but I think it's time to If we don't face it now, when are we going to face it? And you're going to have to hurt some feelings, unfortunately. Like you said yourself, Mr. Mayor, it's not just paper clips now. It's more serious, unfortunately. I have a couple more items here. As far as the effects of the budget on property values, this is the false narrative I hear over and over and over again, not just on the town budget, but on the Board of Ed budget. If it were true to any degree whatsoever, then our home values would increase somewhere along the lines of the spending. Unfortunately, based on the fact that the grand list has not budged in 10 years, then that obviously proves itself to be false. So I hate to keep hearing that over and over again. Maybe we could say that it's maintaining the values, but it's surely not increasing the values. So again, you know, historically I've supported you. I think it's a great group of people here. I can't think of any one of you that I would like to see replaced. So, but you're leaving us in a difficult situation on our end too, and whether to support you or not, I'm not sure. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Michael Fox, 1901 Main Street. Mr. Mayor, town councilors. First of all, I want to congratulate all of you on the way you've worked with each other, even through this budget season. I didn't see the majority, I didn't see it anyway, you know, pushing their weight around, nor did I see the minority councilors being thorns in the majority side. You all seem to be working together and talking before, during, and after the meetings. That having been said, now I got my complaints. I know that, you know, there's a problem with income. We can't really depend on the state legislature. Everything is expensive, and income is not increasing. Our grand list is not increasing. However, our school system still has to function. They are not so flat. They have contractual agreements by which they have to comply, and giving, quote unquote, the school system a 0.03% increase in their budget is just about like a decrease because of these contractual agreements. Last year, there was the same problem. On the board, the mayor had, on the screen, the mayor had a figure of something like 3.1% that went increased to the Board of Ed last year. I don't remember that. I think it was less. I think maybe for a few things, you know, together it might have been. At any rate, 0.03, you know, is only hurting our kids. I brought three kids up through the school system, and now I've got six grandchildren, one already graduated, going through the school system now, all the way from kindergarten to a senior in high school. And I would hate to see these younger kids keep going to school and the school can't keep up. So I would appreciate it if, you know, even if you don't go back up to the 2.65 that the superintendent suggested, maybe at least to the 2.0% that the town manager suggested. As far as the government, as government goes, I do really believe you should think again about increasing the library's budget. You know, my granddaughters can't go to the library during the week because their mother works. Their mother's a teacher and 40, 50 miles away, so she gets home late and nobody can take them. So Sunday is one of the best days, and they also have a lot of good programs. I also noticed that the senior center is not going to get enough money to replace some of their equipment. And I know they need it because I'm there almost every day. I may not be the oldest one there, but I am there. The parking rec can use a little
more. Summarize, please, Mr. Fox.
No problem, Mr. Mayor. I'm just about done. And, you know, in summary, please, you know, sit there today. You're going to be making adjustments. Try to listen to the people that are asking for a little more money. Thank you. And once again, thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Gary Bowles, 28 Burden Lane, lifelong Newington resident. Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the town council, town manager, members of the public. I want to give some praise. I want to thank Ann Harder, finance director, Lisa Rydecki, I think it is, assistant finance director, Jamie Trevethan, executive assistant to the town manager, Jane Kalinich, executive secretary, and of course, Tanya Lane, our town manager, for their due diligence and hard work on this town budget. I am very pleased with the proposed new mill rate of 36.59. I think that's correct. I know you all worked hard on this, and we certainly appreciate your due diligence. Like I said, this is a responsible budget. It should be passed at this juncture. I do not support the $1.8 million purchase of the St. Mary's School. What I would support is the improvements that desperately need to be done to what I went to was known as Northwest School, which is now Anna Reynolds School. I went there in 1955 through 1957, I believe it was. So thank you very much, and I wish you all well.
Thank you. Anyone else? On. Yes, this is the town council. Oh, Ms. Foley. Oh, wait a minute. Let me put you on speaker and make sure you identify yourself properly. Okay. Go ahead.
Good evening, Mayor, and good evening, town councilors. First, a thank you to all that you've done and to get us to this point. I know it has been quite a trying budget season with plenty of meetings. I look at the budget and wonder...
Patty, identify yourself for the record, please.
Patty Foley, 51 at Crown Ridge. I thank you very much for all that you have done. This budget is difficult, and it's difficult for a lot of departments and plenty of my neighbors, friends, and soon have all mentioned their various facts they'd like to see increases. I think holding the line is extremely important. And when I spoke earlier at a budget meeting, I said we need to see our town with new eyes. And I really do mean that. We need to find better ways to do what we currently do. There are ways to save money. I've spoken with several of you about objectives that could be set that would allow us to continue our services, but at a less expensive rate. As to the school's budget, I don't know. I looked at the year-end financials for the school and found that math and reading, as I brought up last year, were over budget, or I should say underspent of the budget, by close to $700,000. You've asked me to pay for math and reading, and yet we don't spend it on math or reading. To sum it up, yes, we have some looming news over our head from the state. We need to be prepared for that, and it's better to be prepared today as it is than to continue to spend and find us in a worse position later. I just want to say thank you for the budget. Thank you for your hard work, and I will say good night.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Roy, you got the letter? The letter?
Do we have letters? Do you have a letter?
We didn't all get it, though.
It just was sent to three of us.
Okay. Go ahead.
Okay. This is from Karen Kaplick. As a substitute working at the reference desk at Lucy Robbins Wells Library, I am asking the council to consider making no future cuts to the library's budget for the upcoming fiscal year and to restore Sunday hours. I strongly feel that the library is a cornerstone of the Newington community and that a reduced budget would seriously compromise the valuable services and materials offered to the town's citizens. The library is such a vital part of the town for many reasons. It makes available to its patrons information for personal, educational, medical, career-related, and economic purposes, to name a few. Additionally, the library provides resources to provide to help keep up with today's fast-paced technology, which is changing the world. Access to such information to a wide diversity of people of all age groups is of paramount importance to the community 7 days a week. Starting with children who are in their infant and toddler years, the library offers educational opportunities by encouraging reading at a very young age through its story times and other activities. As these children get older, the library serves as a place where students conduct their research, homework, and reading assignments. Additionally, the library helps to keep the public informed and educated through its many free programs offered throughout the year. From healthcare, retirement, investments to music, entertainment, travel, and art, the library serves as a focal point. In many cases, part of the community would not be able to become fully informed about many of these subjects if it was not for the library. It is also a social place where the public gathers for club meetings, book clubs, study sessions, etc. Rooms can be reserved for a host of reasons, which is a convenience to the public, especially on Sundays. With future budget cuts and no Sunday hours, the public would not be properly served. The community would indeed suffer if Lucy Robbins Wells Library were not able to sufficiently continue its important mission. Karen Kaplick.
Are there any other letters that have come in? Is there anyone else from the public who wish to speak? If not, I'll call for a motion to adjourn the public hearing.
So moved.
Moved by Councilor Nagel. Second?
Second.
Your second?
Second.
Councilor Marquini. Okay. Councilor Marquini. Sorry. Okay. The gentleman in pink. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Yes. We are adjourned.